I'm the head of the Department of Physics, and it's my honor and pleasure to introduce today's speaker, Professor Kam-Biu Luk, who comes from the University of California at Berkeley. Professor Luk received his bachelor's degree in physics at the University of Hong Kong in the 1970s, and eventually a PhD at Rutgers University in the 80s. And he's been a member of the University of California, Berkeley faculty since 1989, where he's currently professor of physics. He's also a senior member of the physics division of Lawrence Berkeley Laboratory, National Laboratory, which sits up on the hill above the university. And we're fortunate to have an affiliation with Professor Luk. He's the IAS Senior Visiting Fellow here at HKUST, and also coupled with the main academic building, he's a visiting professor in the Department of Physics. Professor Luk has conducted research on neutrino oscillations and charge parity violations. He is a leader, a co-leader of the Diabay Reactor Neutrino Experiment, assembling a team of multinational scientists from the U.S., China, Czech Republic, Taiwan. He and his collaborator at the Institute of High Energy Physics in Beijing, Professor Yifang Wang, were awarded the prestigious Panofsky Prize in Experimental Particle Physics in 2014 from the American Physical Society. And the citation is for their leadership of the Diabay experiment, which produced the first definitive measurement of theta-1-3 angle in neutrino mixing matrix. So I won't talk anymore. I think you want to hear Professor Luk. So please, Kam-Biu, will you come in and tell us about what happens at reactors?
Well, thank you for the nice introduction, and also it's my pleasure to be a member of IAS and also in the physics department for this semester. Today, I'm going to tell you something about neutrino physics that done using the nuclear reactors. So rather than just focusing on the Diabay experiment, I feel that it's better to give you an overview of the experiments that can be done with nuclear reactors, because a lot of the time we only hear say very negative comments about nuclear reactors. However, as far as science is concerned, nuclear reactors are very useful, a very powerful tool for studying neutrino physics. So as you know, neutrino is a fundamental particles of nature, and a lot of the properties of the neutrino are not that well known. So in order to study neutrinos, we have to really come up with say sources, and it turns out nuclear reactor is a fantastic tool to give us the neutrinos. Now, one of the reasons why nuclear reactor is useful is because remember neutrinos are weakly interacting particles, so they don't like to interact with matter that easily. So in order to really study any property of the neutrinos, we have to first of all have a very intense source. Secondly, we have to have a very large target in order to intercept a decent number of neutrinos, so that we can then begin to study its properties. Now, if we look at a typical nuclear reactor, then you will see that this is the so-called the core of the reactor. Essentially, you will see a lot of rods containing pellets of uranium-238, enriched with about 3 to 5% of uranium-235. Now, when we have the core running to generate electricity, what happens inside the reactor or the core is that from the uranium-238 decay, then we get a very good number of neutrons. And when some of these neutrons run into the uranium-235, then it can induce nuclear fission. So subsequently, then we produce other very short-lived radioisotopes that can essentially decay, okay, right away, full, okay, beta decay, so give us the electron, along with, okay, the electron antineutrino. And for, okay, a typical reactor, say, for instance, that can generate about 1 gigawatt of electricity, and it can produce, okay, 6 × 10⁰, okay, antineutrinos per second. So this is extremely, okay, intense. And it's because of, okay, this, okay, abundance of, okay, antineutrinos, subsequently we can do, okay, experiment. Now, another interesting thing about, okay, the antineutrinos produced by nuclear reactor is, okay, that these antineutrinos are very low energy. So we can see, you know, essentially we run out of, okay, antineutrino by the time we get to about, okay, 10 MeV. And they are coming from essentially four major radioisotopes. Okay, we have mentioned about, okay, say the uranium-238 and the 235. And then during the fission process, then we produce, okay, you know, the polonium. So this are used, okay, for, you know, nuclear weapons. So that's the reason why, you know, the people, you know, are so concerned about, okay, North Korea and Iran, okay, when they build, okay, say the so-called commercially, you know, the nuclear reactors. Now, another interesting thing about, you know, the four major, okay, radioisotopes is that at time zero, that is when we, okay, begin to use, okay, the nuclear fuel, then we start, okay, to use up, okay, the 238 and also, you know, the 235 and produce, okay, the two, okay, plutonium, okay, isotopes. So as a result, okay, when we look at, okay, say the time evolution of the composition of, okay, the nuclear fuel, then you see, okay, the they all, okay, have, okay, you know, different trends. You know, of course, okay, for the uraniums, they are going down, you know, the in percentage, whereas, okay, for the two, you know, the, you know, plutonium, they are, okay, the, you know, the increasing. Now, because of, okay, say this, okay, time variation in the nuclear fuel, then, okay, the energy spectrum of the antineutrino coming from a nuclear reactor actually depends on time. So this is, okay, say some of the disadvantage of, okay, using nuclear reactor. So that means, okay, when we do experiment in particular, if we have to know the number of antineutrinos produced, okay, by the nuclear reactor at a particular time, then we have to know, okay, exactly, you know, say the this, okay, details of the nuclear cycle. And you'll see, okay, that this, okay, hammers, okay, the, you know, some of the experiments that using, okay, nuclear reactor, you know, the, in a minute. Now, once, okay, now we understand why and how, okay, we get antineutrinos from a reactor, then we can begin now to look at, okay, how we utilize, you know, the antineutrinos to do, okay, fundamental physics. Now, in particular, okay, for this talk, I will only, okay, focus on, you know, some historical, you know, discovery, you know, the first observation of the antineutrino in the 50s. And then, okay, more recently, how we use, okay, the nuclear reactors to study, okay, neutrino oscillations. In particular, I will, okay, cover, okay, these three topics, you know, how we discover neutrino oscillation using nuclear reactor and the current, okay, the activities, namely, you know, how, okay, we determine the values of, okay, this neutrino mixing angle theta 1-3, and also search for, okay, say, some hypothetical, okay, neutrino that we call, okay, steric neutrino, and also, okay, in the future, how we can use nuclear reactor to address, okay, another major issues related to, okay, neutrino oscillation. And then towards the end of, okay, my talk, then I will, okay, also say a few words about how we use nuclear reactor to, okay, look for, you know, the magnetic moment of, you know, the neutrino, which is, okay, one of the fundamental property of, you know, okay, the elementary particle. So now let me, you know, just, okay, now follow history. So in the 50s, shortly after, you know, okay, Fermi and companies controlled, okay, nuclear fission, that led to, okay, essentially, you know, the construction of, okay, nuclear reactors, okay, for generating electricity. And of course, okay, at the same time, that was during the end of the Second World War, the US government built, okay, say, this nuclear power plant in, okay, Savannah River to essentially produce okay nuclear weapons. Now, however, okay, to okay, the Professor Rines and Dr. Nokowin, this is okay really a gold mine. So this is okay the first time we use okay nuclear reactor to okay study neutrino physics. So in particular, at that time, nobody had seen the anti-neutrino or the neutrino okay experimentally. It was only okay a posterity by Pauli to account for the beta spectrum of the electron. Now in this classic experiment, this gentleman essentially used this detector a little bit underground to show off some of the cosmic ray background, and they use roughly about 1 ton of organic liquid scintillator to capture the anti-neutrino. The reason why they use organic scintillator is because essentially this is hydrocarbon, which is very rich in proton. So what happens when we have an anti-neutrino coming into the liquid scintillator, once in a while, then it will collide with the proton to give us the positron and also the neutron. Now if we look at the motion of the positron, then we find out that when it slows down in the liquid, then it will emit scintillating light, and at the end it will then annihilate with the atomic electron inside the liquid to give us two gamma rays. Those are subsequently converted into visible light. So that will be then detected by say these two detectors labeled AB, which is essentially water with a little bit of cadmium chloride there. So this the signal produced by the positron is very fast. So usually this is what we call a prompt signal in nuclear neutrino using the reactor neutrino experiment. Now how about the neutron? It turns out that the neutron has very little kinetic energy from this so-called inverse beta decay reaction. It will have some kind of random rock inside the liquid and giving away its kinetic energy. And then at the end of its path, then it will capture either by a proton to give us a deuterium atom, and then with the emission of a single gamma ray. However, if we put some cadmium into our detector, then sometimes the neutron will be captured by the cadmium, and this time it will give rise to a bunch of gamma rays. And this will essentially constitute a so-called delay signal. Now in this experiment done in the 50s, this is one example to indicate how experimentally we detect or deduce the existence of the anti-neutrino. So you can see at the beginning, they had a detector to look at the signal corresponding to the positron. So you see the two signals in detector 2 and 3 region, so over here. And then tens of microseconds later, then they see another two signals coincident in time, indicating essentially the capture of the neutron. Now of course if you have only one event, you cannot tell whether this is really anti-neutrino candidate or not. However, if you continue to do experiment for a long period of time, then basically using the statistics, then you can tell whether indeed you have observed this ghostly particle or not. So indeed, throughout a few years, these two gentlemen then discover the anti-neutrino. Now, more importantly, this pioneer experiment also essentially provide the techniques nowadays we still continue to use to in nuclear reactors or neutrino experiments. And you'll see again in a few minutes. And also talking about Nobel Prize, so the Professor Reiners received the prize in 1995. So it was a long overdue. Okay. Now, if you now fast forward, besides the electron neutrino discovered by the previous experiment, nowadays we know there are two other kinds. So altogether, we have three kinds of of neutrinos. Okay, so-called the standard model of particle physics. So these are the electron type, the muon type, and the tau type. Now, one interesting thing about these three kinds of neutrino is that according to the theoretical the speculation, they are not independent of each other. Instead, actually, these three the neutrinos that we observe in laboratory are related to three so-called the neutrinos with definite masses called one, two, and three. And mathematically, that means the electron neutrino actually is a linear combination of these three neutrinos with masses, or we call the mass eigenstates. Now, this linear combination is expressed as a matrix that we call the PMMS, the mixing matrix. And it turns out mathematically, this matrix, 3x3 matrix, actually can be described by only four parameters. This theta 1, 2, 2, 3, and 1, 3 are what we call the mixing angle. And then there's also another the parameter we call the delta that represent essentially a phase. All right. Now, more importantly, if we now look at these three mass eigenstates, it turns out they have well-defined masses that we label that M1, M2, and M3. Now, using these three masses, then actually we can form another kind of combination, essentially using the square of the masses and take the difference. That is what we call the mass square difference here. Now, these are important for describing the neutrino oscillation we'll see in the next slide. Now, more importantly, if this neutrino mixing idea is correct, then it will imply neutrinos have mass. Okay? And this will, if this is true, that means, the standard model we have now, is not complete. We have to, modify it, somehow. So, then the question is whether, neutrino, the mixing, is correct. Now, in order to test this idea, then we have to now come to, a phenomenon that we can observe experimentally. It's called neutrino oscillation. Now, it turns out that the matrix can be factorized into three matrices. Each one is controlled by one mixing angle. So this one, theta 1, 2, and this is 2, 3, and then the middle one is, what we call the 1, 3, and then using our convention, then, the other, the independent parameter, the phase, delta, is, coupled to, the theta 1, 3 here, like that. Now, if we use, these mixing angles and also, the mass square differences, then it turns out then we can write down the probability for, different kind of, the neutrino transformation. So for instance, the neutrino, if we start off with the electron type, it can remain as, electron type after a certain distance L. And this is, E is not the energy of, the neutrino. Now, if you look at this expression here, then you have the second term, which is very important for us to look at. And here you can see that we have sine squared 2 theta of the mixing angle. Now, it turns out this part represents essentially the amplitude of an oscillation. And then the second part here, dictated by the mass squared difference, essentially will tell us the frequency of the oscillation or the wavelength of the oscillation. So this is essentially a consequence of neutrino mixing. Now then the question is do we really see neutrino oscillation? And it turns out indeed we discovered it. So the beginning of the story was when Professor Davis deploying the experiment in the homestead mine in South Dakota in the US to essentially count the number of the neutrinos coming from the sun. Now, at that time, he was interested to use the neutrinos coming from the sun to deduce the nuclear fusion process inside of the sun. So this was the purpose of the experiment. Now the way he measured the number of neutrinos coming from the sun is used this reaction. So in the detector here, you notice we instead of 1 ton detector, now we go to 600 ton of the bridging the solution that we use to do our laundry. So because the solution is very rich in chlorine, so when we have the neutrino coming from the sun interact with the chlorine once in a while, then it will give us the electron, and also now the chlorine atom is converted into argon. So what Davis did was to count up the number of argon atoms in the detector essentially about once a month or so. And you can see during this period of time, he had measured the number of argon atoms like this. And as a matter of fact, when I was a graduate student around 80s or so, when I look at this result, then I talk to my senior colleagues about their opinions of the measurement. At that time, everybody said, don't pay attention. Davis didn't know what he was doing. All right. However, after all the years, then you can see the error of the measurement is reduced. So very clearly, there's something very different from the theoretical prediction based on what we know about the sun. So why we have such a big difference? At that time, we thought it might be due to our ignorance about the sun, or there's indeed something wrong with the solar neutrino. Now we are talking about essentially the late 90s, and certainly at that time there were other experiments trying to independently cross-check the measurement of the Davis. And one of the key experiments was Kamlan in Japan. So this is a look at this experiment. Essentially, it is a 1 kiloton liquid scintillator detector in a deep underground experimental hall in the Japanese Alp. Now the nice thing about this experiment is this detector is surrounded by 55 Japanese the nuclear reactors. At that time all of them were running, and because of the abundance of nuclear reactors, as a result we could essentially detect the number of anti-neutrinos coming from all the reactors at a distance somewhere equivalent to about 180 kilometers. So this is relatively long distance. So the question we want to answer is, if we know the number of reactor neutrinos coming from all the reactors, by the time they got to Kamlan, how many we would see. Now, this is a very important experiment. As a matter of fact, this was the first man-made neutrino source experiment. So we have control. We know exactly what happened at the beginning, and then we see we see by the time the anti-neutrino gets to our detector. Now, to give you some idea, even though this is 1 kiloton detector, it's really big. It's about 13 meters in diameter. And it took us several months to fill this balloon with liquid scintillator. At that time, before we did the experiment, we predicted that we should see only about 2 neutrinos per day. All right? So this is just to show you how hard that it is to study neutrinos. Now, however, after the experiment ran for a couple of years, what we observe is something like this. The black dots are our data points, and you can see comparing with the prediction of the number of antineutrinos we should see if there is if there were no neutrino oscillation, then we should see the black histogram. And it's very clearly, the prediction is very different from what we observe. So this is what we call a deficit of reactant anti-neutrinos. And furthermore, if you look at, say, the number of anti-neutrino detected as a function of the energy of the incoming anti-neutrino, you see, the shape is different from, the prediction. So this is what we call, the spectral distortion. So by, looking at the total number of, the detected events and also, the energy distribution subsequently, then you can confirm whether, we are seeing something, similar to, neutrino oscillation. Now, if we indeed interpret, the experimental data as, neutrino oscillation, then we can then, using the formula we just, went through in the other slide, then we can extract the values for, the corresponding mixing angle and also the mass square difference. So from Kamen, essentially, this is, what we observe. These two fundamental parameters. Now, of course, besides Kamen, we have to use other techniques to cross-check the hypothesis of neutrino mixing and also neutrino oscillation. And it turns out just about the same time as the Kamen, there was another experiment called Snow in Canada, using heavy water to detect the neutrinos coming from the sun, and using four different kind of reactions induced by the incoming solar neutrinos. So subsequently, using these four processes, the Snow experiment indeed observed the correct number of solar neutrino when we sum up the number of neutrinos detected using these four processes. And essentially, they confirm indeed the missing electron neutrino coming from the sun converted into the muon type or the tau type, represented by this y-axis. And this x-axis is the number of solar neutrinos we obtain. So, and more importantly, the experimental result, when we sum up, this two kind of fluxes is consistent with the prediction by the standard solar model. So therefore, indeed, there's nothing wrong with the sun. And between Kamen and Snow, essentially, we concluded the deficit of the solar neutrino is due to neutrino oscillation. And also in the 90s, when the Super K experiment and also the previous experiment, Kam-Biu Luk studying atmospheric neutrinos, now this time, is the muon type. They also observed, essentially some of the atmospheric, the muon neutrino disappear. This is red curve is the prediction, and this is what they observe. Now again, this source is given by nature, so therefore we have to also test it using a control experiment. So using neutrino beams produced by accelerator, for instance, the recently completed MINO experiment done in the US, and you can see again the experimental data is different from the prediction by quite a lot. So this essentially the evidence proving that neutrino oscillation does exist, and as a result, using all this experiment, then we can determine the mixing parameters. So from Kamen and also from Snow, now we know that the mixing angle theta 1-2 is about 34 degrees, is quite large. And then using the atmospheric neutrino and also the accelerator muon neutrino beam, we also now can determine the mixing angle of theta 2-3 to be about 45 degrees. So this is so-called maximal mixing. Now, however, in the year 2011, we still did not know the size of theta 1-3, and certainly we have no idea about the phase, and also among the three masses, we have no idea which one is the lightest or the heaviest. So if we can have an arrangement of these three masses in this order, this is what we call the normal mass hierarchy, or The third one, the M3, could be the lightest. The other two, are the heavier one. So this is what we call, the inverted, mass hierarchy. So these are, the remaining questions, we have to address. As a matter of fact, among the three, the theta 1-3, was, the most, important one about, a decade ago, to the point, when Sheldon Glashow visited the newly established center in Tohoku University, he put down, the question, tell me theta 1-3. So to tell your story, 2 years ago, Sheldon and I were in the meeting, so I posted this one, and then I said, now I tell you the answer. Because that was the time we have measured theta 1-3. So why theta 1-3 was so important in the last several years? Now besides being one of the fundamental parameters of nature, in order for us to completely understand how neutrino favors are tied to the other three mass eigenstates, we have to know theta 1-3, because knowing that, then it will allow us to predict other phenomena that will require knowing the composition of the electron neutrino. And furthermore, once we know the size of theta 1-3, then we will know whether we can essentially have a new future program, for instance, measuring the mass hierarchy, and also whether we will have CP violation in the neutrino sector. That means essentially experimentally, then we can look at the oscillation of of the muon type, and then look at the oscillation of the antiparticle, and see whether they oscillate the same way or not. Now, if they do not oscillate the same way, then it turns out by doing the experiment, measure these two oscillation probabilities, then essentially then we can through this expression to determine the phase over there. Now, however, from this expression you can see if theta 1-3 is zero, then basically there's no way we can do future experiment. So that's the reason why theta 1-3 was so important. Now, we can essentially determine the whether theta 1-3 is zero or not using either accelerator beam or using the nuclear reactor. So I'm going to tell you how we measure theta 1-3 using the nuclear reactor. Now it turns out if we write down the full expression for oscillation of the electron antineutrino, it's given this a little bit more complicated expression. Now, if we look at essentially these two terms one by one, then we find out the term controlled by theta 1-3 is described by green curve. If we have theta 1-3 being non-zero, then this term will be the largest when we have a detector from, say, the reactor about 2 kilometers or so. So this is what we learned about the first term. And then for the second term, you can see essentially it's controlled by the mixing angle theta 1-2. And notice because delta M squared 2-1 is small, so that translates to essentially a very long wavelength like that. All right? So in this case, you can see at 2 kilometers or so, this term is not important because that's the blue curve here. So that tells us in order for us to determine theta 1-3 using nuclear reactor, what we need to do is to put a detector somewhere around here, 2 kilometers from the reactors, and then also put another detector close to the reactor so that we can use this to count the number of antineutrino coming out from the reactor. Now, if we use this approach proposed essentially by two Russian colleagues, at the turn of this millennium, then basically when we compare the results of the near and the far detector, essentially a lot of the systematic uncertainty will be cancelled. So this will allow us, okay, essentially to measure theta run-free, you know, okay, unambiguously, and also, okay, very cleanly. So this is essentially, you know, the approach, okay, we use in the current run of reactor neutrino experiments. Now, at this moment, worldwide, there are three experiments, okay, using this technique to go after, okay, theta run-free. So the first one is, okay, we call the double shell experiment using the shell nuclear reactor near the border of France and Belgium. And then we have, okay, the dive experiment in our backyard. And then, okay, another one is called Reno, using, okay, the nuclear power plant in, okay, in Gwangwang in South Korea. Now, among this, okay, three experiments, you can see from this, okay, table, Taipei essentially, you know, is the most, okay, the powerful experiment, you know, for this measurement. We have, okay, the most powerful nuclear power plant, so that, okay, we get a lot of antineutrinos. And furthermore, we have, you know, the very large, okay, you know, detectors. So to give you some idea, for the near detectors, we have, okay, essentially 40 tons of liquid scintillator in two, okay, separate near sites, and then 80 tons of liquid scintillator in the far site. So you can see, okay, essentially, okay, it's about a factor of 2 to 5, okay, larger than the other two experiments. And also another thing which is very important is, okay, how much, okay, say, rock shielding we have over the detectors. For Taipei, you can see, okay, we have very good, okay, shielding. So as a result, you know, cosmic ray is not, okay, say, a very serious issue to us. Whereas, okay, for double show and also for Reno, you can see, okay, that, you know, they have, okay, less, okay, you know, rock coverage. So as a result, you know, they suffer more, okay, background coming from, okay, cosmic ray than Taipei. So now let me just, okay, quickly go through, you know, these three experiments to give you some idea about, okay, say, what we have learned, you know, through them. So the first one is, okay, the double shell experiments. So we can see, okay, that this pair of, okay, nuclear reactors, and then about, okay, a kilometer in here, then they have the far detector, and they also have a near detector which is about, okay, 400 meters away from, you know, the two, okay, the cores. However, you know, they were behind schedule. As a result, the near detector, you know, did not get finished until only, you know, okay, the end of last year. So as a result, you know, okay, the measurements I'm going to tell you from, say, double show is, okay, essentially using only the far detector. So as a result, you know, they suffer from the uncertainty of, okay, the nuclear power reactors. All right, so now let me just, okay, tell you, okay, what they learned first. So this is a picture showing, okay, a detector which is very similar to, you know, the detector we use in Taipei and also in Reno. So the color part is, okay, the liquid scintillator used, okay, to intercept the antineutrinos. And the visible light coming from the reactions are detected by, you know, photomultiply tubes populating, okay, on the outside wall of the detector. Now, the double shell experiment, okay, started first among the three, and by, you know, the end of, okay, the 2011, then they obtained, okay, the, you know, quite a number of data. However, they jumped the gun because, okay, they worry, okay, the Taipei and Reno with scoop them. So therefore, you know, they announced, okay, the first result first. So in this case, using, you know, the far detector, then they obtained, okay, the deficit of, okay, reactor antineutrino observed with the detector is about, okay, say, you know, 5 to 6% less than expectation. However, you can see because, okay, they have only one detector, so they suffer from, okay, say, the uncertainty in predicting, you know, say, the number of, okay, antineutrino coming in, and also, okay, the energy distribution. So because of, okay, the large, okay, systematic, you can see essentially the measurement reported by double show was not conclusive. You could not really tell whether, okay, theta 1-3, you know, okay, was zero or not zero. So we can see, okay, from this deficit, this is, okay, the values of sine squared 2 theta 1-3, you know, they obtained. So it's only roughly about, okay, one standard deviation from zero. So the next one is the die bay. This is the collaboration that might mention in the introduction. So essentially, it's an experiment that carried out by Asia in particular, China at large, and also U.S. and then two groups from Europe, and also one of my postdocs became a faculty member in Chile. So now we have one institution from the South America too. Now probably a lot of you have heard about Dai Bay, but you may not know exactly where it is. So this is the map of Hong Kong and Shenzhen. So you can see essentially the Dai Bay nuclear power plant essentially is on the east side of the Shenzhen township. If we use the Victoria Harbor as a reference, then the Dai Bay nuclear power station is about 55 kilometers away. Then if we now go to the power plant, then this is what you see. So you see there are three nuclear power stations. So this is the oldest one, Dai Bay nuclear power plant. And then these are the two Lingao nuclear power stations. And so this Lingao 2 is the newest one. Now, since we have three groups of the nuclear reactors, so as a result, in order to count the number of antineutrinos coming out from them, we need essentially two near sites. So one is what we call the EH1, which is about 400 meters from the two reactors. And then for the Lingao nuclear power plants, they are about 500 meters away from our second experimental hall. And then about 2 kilometers into the mountain, then this is our far site that can contain detectors to detect the antineutrinos. So the idea now you can see we use these two to predict what we observe here, and if they are different, then we see something interesting. So this is how we do it, and indeed, just before Christmas Eve of 2011, then. We started to take data using only 6 out of the 8 detectors we have. So in the EH1 near hall, we have two detectors in place. And then in the EH2, we had one. And then in the far hall, we had 3 more. Now using these 6 detectors, then we obtained sufficient data by February of 2012 for us to essentially determine ambiguously that we have seen some of the reactor antineutrino disappear. So it's about 6%. And also notice now, because we are doing a near and far the relative measurement, so as a result, contrary to the double show experiment, our systematic uncertainty is very small. So because we have reached a statistical significance of better than 5 standard deviation, so therefore we decide it's time for us to report the result right away. And also from this deficit, then for the first time we show unambiguously that the theta 1-3 definitely is not zero, and you can see this paper now. Shortly after the Dai Bay experiment, then the Reno experiment also announced the result. So before I show you the result, let me show you the layout of the Reno experiment. So again, similar to Dai Bay, there are 6 nuclear reactors lined up in a straight line, and along the bisector, about 1.4 kilometer away, then they have the far detector underground. And then about 300 meters behind them, this reactors is the near detectors like that. So again, using the near and the far detectors, then they can do a relative measurement. So about a month after Dai Bay announced the result, then Reno also announced the first result, confirming indeed some of their antineutrinos, okay, also disappear. And you can see, okay, that the result is very similar to diabate. However, okay, the values of theta 1,3, okay, coming from Reno at that time, you know, was higher than the diabate experiment. Now, so you may say, okay, now, okay, we know theta 1,3, okay, is not zero. So what else can we do? So naturally, now we have moved from the discovery phase into, okay, essentially a precision measurement of the error for, you know, theta 1,3. So for, okay, the double show experiment, as I said, because, okay, they only started taking data with the near and the far only recently. So as a result, okay, the, in 2014, the only thing that they could do was to collect more events and also, okay, the understand, try to understand, okay, that the systematic better. So as a result, you know, last year they began to see, okay, a free standard deviation significance of, okay, a non-zero theta 1,3. And also notice now, okay, the value for theta 1,3, okay, is also similar to, okay, what we observed, okay, in the diabate experiment. Now, for, okay, diabate, we continue to take data after this discovery, and by now we have detected well over a million antineutrino events in our experiment. So this is, okay, essentially the largest sample of reactor neutrino data, okay, in the world. Because, okay, we have such a large, okay, the data set, we can now, okay, measure, you know, the theta 1,3, okay, quite precisely. And furthermore, throughout the year, we improve our understanding of, okay, how to measure the energy as, okay, accurate as we can. So just, okay, 3 weeks ago, then we reported, you know, that the most precise measurement of theta 1,3 in the world. So you can see here now, comparing with, okay, what we observed in our first measurement, now the error bars, okay, are a lot smaller. And furthermore, using, you know, the energy distribution, naturally you can see, okay, the data points are lower than, okay, the prediction corresponding with no oscillation. If we take the ratio of these two, then now you can see, okay, very clearly, and we see, okay, say the how, okay, the difference between prediction and the data is as a function of the energy. So the red line is, okay, the best fit to our data, giving us, okay, the, you know, the values of, you know, theta 1,3 and so on. Now, however, if besides, okay, measuring theta 1,3, actually this time we can also extract another, okay, important parameter, the mass square difference corresponding to, okay, the oscillation associated with theta 1,3. So this is, okay, what we observed, okay, the, you know, 3 weeks ago. So now you can see sine square 2 theta 1,3 is now known to about, okay, 6% or so. Our first measurement was about 15%, just to show you, okay, say the improvement. And then for, okay, say the mass square difference, we also now, this is the second time we reported, let's say, this value. And also now, instead of 10% in our first measurement, now, okay, the uncertainty in this, okay, mass square difference now is reduced down to about 5% or so. Now, the interesting thing, okay, about, okay, say the, this, okay, delta M square is, okay, now we can compare the measurement done using, okay, nuclear reactor with, okay, atmospheric neutrino experiments, like, okay, the super K experiment or the ice cube in the South Pole, or using, okay, accelerator beam. In this case, all these experiments using, okay, the muon neutrino, and they can measure, okay, something similar to delta M square. And from, say, this measurements, then basically we can then deduce, you know, the size of this delta M square 3.2. Remember, this is, okay, one of the important, you know, parameter governing, you know, neutrino oscillation. And you can see now, okay, the diabate can achieve a precision comparable to, you know, okay, say the accelerated beam experiments. And furthermore, you can see, you know, that they are more or less, okay, consistent with each other. That tells us, okay, essentially all the neutrino oscillation experiments are in favor of only having three generation of neutrinos. So this is, okay, something, okay, important and also, you know, that you should keep in mind. Now, to just, okay, show you indeed, okay, we have neutrino oscillation. Now let's look at, okay, the the energy distribution or the deficit of, okay, say the experiment. Now this time, instead of, okay, looking at the energy like this one, or okay, just okay, say the distance. Now this time we look at it as a function of the ratio L over M. Remember, okay, the term governing the oscillation is, okay, the mass square difference times L over E. Okay, so therefore this is, okay, a reduced, okay, the quantity that will tell us, okay, more about, okay, say the oscillation. So indeed, when we use, okay, say this ratio, then you see, okay, for the diode experiment, naturally you see, okay, a sinusoidal curve. Now if we do the same thing, you know, to the Camland data, we see, okay, the oscillation, as a matter of fact, okay, you know, a very beautiful, okay, cycle. So you can see now, okay, from this two, okay, the reactor neutrino experiments, basically we have essentially, okay, provide comparing evidence showing, okay, the, you know, say how the solar neutrino disappear and also the atmospheric neutrino, okay, through no neutrino oscillation. Now then Reactors also updated the result quite recently. And now you can similar to, okay, Diabe, they observe, okay, say the, you know, the oscillation pattern. And also now they have, okay, the a new value of sine square 2 theta 1 3. Now instead of, okay, say 0.11, now, okay, they have dropped down to, okay, about 0.09, which is, okay, essentially now consistent with, okay, Diabe. And also, okay, for the delta M square, they also obtain something very similar to, okay, the, you know, the what we have seen in Diabe experiment. So these three experiments are still ongoing. So if we now, okay, look into the future, and this is, okay, what we expect to see, you know, as far as, okay, theta 1 3 is concerned. So you can see, you know, that for, you know, say double show, because, okay, they have, okay, the rather, okay, the weak nuclear power plant comparing with the other two experiments, and also not that their target is a lot smaller. So as a result, even if they use, okay, the near and the far detector together, after, okay, a few more years of running, essentially they can only measure, okay, sine square 2 theta 1 3 to about, okay, say 0.01. So that is, okay, roughly about 10% measurement. And then for Reno, they also plan, okay, to continue to run, okay, for a few more years. And they expect, okay, by the time they finish the experiment, then they can reach, okay, a precision on sine square 2 theta 1 3 to be about 0.05. Now, whereas, okay, for Diabe, we'll reach, okay, essentially, you know, the 0.03 by the end of 2017. And you can also see, okay, the trend of, okay, all these three experiments. After a few years of running, essentially, okay, we are essentially, okay, you know, limited by, you know, say the, you know, systematic. So in this case, it's almost no point, okay, to continue to run. So you may say by the end of this decade, then basically, okay, we know, okay, the values of theta 1 3, okay, quite well, and it's very likely, by combining these three experiments, the ultimate precision of theta 1 3, okay, will reach, okay, roughly about, okay, 3% or so. Now, why, okay, theta 1 3, okay, is useful? In particular, the one obtained, okay, by, you know, say the reactor experiments. Now, as I said, we can also, okay, say find out whether theta 1 3 is zero or not, essentially using accelerator beam. So right now there are two experiments, okay, running in the world. One is, okay, the so-called the T2K experiment in Japan, and then another one just, okay, just came online about a year ago. It's, okay, the NOVA in the U.S. So at this moment, okay, we don't have, no, the result from NOVA to look at the same picture yet. So therefore, I use, okay, the T2K, okay, result. Now, one of the disadvantage of, okay, accelerated neutrino beam to study, okay, the values of theta 1 3 is, okay, it turns out, okay, this kind of experiment will start with muon neutrino, and then what they do is, okay, by the time, you know, the beam gets to, you know, the reactor, the detector, then they look for, you know, essentially the transformation of the muon type into the electron type. So this is what we call, okay, the electron neutrino, okay, appearance. Now, About a year ago, T2K altogether observed 28 electron neutrino events in the detector. Now, if theta 1 phi were 0, then they would expect to see only 5. So therefore, you can see certainly 28 is very different from 5. So as a result, now they conclusively come to the this conclusion that theta 1 phi has to be say non-zero. Now, however, in order for them not to extract the values for theta 1 phi, they have to know several things. First of all, essentially they have to know the mass hierarchy. In other words, whether this is a normal type or the inverted type. And furthermore, they have to know the size of the CP phase. So that's why usually for accelerated neutrino beam, then they have to use this way to represent the result. So the y-axis is the phase, and then the x-axis is sine squared 2 theta 1 phi. And then for these two cases, and you can see essentially for the T2K, the values of sine squared 2 theta 1 phi will follow this back curve for the two mass hierarchies. Now, however, because we have already measured theta 1 phi using nuclear reactors, so therefore basically if we impose this input to T2K measurement, then actually we can turn the result around using the T2K result to tell us a little bit about the CP phase. So this is essentially what the T2K collaboration did. So at the end of the day, this is what they find out using the reactor theta 1 phi value. So they find out now, essentially, it's very unlikely this the CP phase delta in the positive region. Okay? Now, remember, there are two ambiguities here because of, the mass hierarchy. So depending on, which one we are talking about, then we'll come up with, different, exclusion. But anyway, if you look at that, basically, it's, based on, the combination of all this experiment, we rule out, this part, looks like, at this moment. And theta 1, the values of theta, should be somewhere, in this region. Now, if you take the T2K value, the result as the phase value, right now, the most likely values for the CP phase is about minus 0.5 the radian. So this is in some sense very remarkable, because this is the first time we have some idea about the size of theta. Now, in order to really pinpoint this phase, then we have to now design new experiment. But we are not going to talk more about the CP phase. So besides getting the values for theta 1 phi and also the mass square difference, it turns out Diabe can do something more than that. Because there are very strong theoretical motivation arguing that we should have some so-called inactive or starry neutrinos exist in the universe. So the question is, is this idea really correct or not? Now, in order to address the existence of such a neutrino, what we need to do now is again go through the phenomenology to and assume that this the starry neutrino can oscillate into the free neutrinos that we are used to. Now, in this case, we modify, now the oscillation probability. So this time, instead of theta 1 phi, then we have a new additional mixing angle called theta 1 4, and also a new mass square difference, called 4 1 now. So let's see what happens. If we say, indeed, we have this kind of sterile and active neutrino oscillation, then theta 1 4 should not be 0. So that means, now this sine squared 2 theta 1 3, remember, represent the oscillation amplitude, should be finite, and this will tell us essentially the oscillation frequency. So if we now put in some value to illustrate what we expect to see, that if we have the starry neutrino, this is what we observe. For instance, if we input this kind of delta m squared value for the 4 1 term, And also, okay, for say the sine squared 2 theta 1 4, that's the amplitude to be about, you know, okay, 0.1. Then we should see, okay, say this is okay, blue curve. Okay, when we look at, okay, the oscillation as a function of the energy of the neutrino. But instead, if you look at now, okay, the dye data for, you know, say the EH2 near Hall, the data points, okay, is very different from, okay, say this expectation. And also, if we go to the far Hall, we also, okay, now have, okay, say, you know, the prediction like this, and then compare with the data. So again, using, okay, say the spectral information, then Diabe can then deduce, okay, the size of, okay, the sine square 2 theta 1 4 and the delta m square. So this is essentially, okay, what we observe. So the y-axis is the delta m square, and this is the x-axis is, okay, say the, you know, the amplitude of the oscillation. And since, okay, we did not see anything consistent with, okay, say expectation, so as a result, we can rule out, okay, the size of sine square 2 theta 1 4 and also delta m square, you know, okay, in this manner. So the area to the left of, okay, the curve, okay, is ruled out. So that means, okay, if, okay, we had any, okay, steroid neutrino, it must, okay, say mix with the other guys only, okay, with say values for these two parameters in this region. And at this moment, okay, that the diabetes, okay, result, okay, the give us, okay, essentially the best limit, okay, the, you know, for this, okay, say light mass steroid neutrino in the world. Now, so much, okay, for, you know, the data. So now let's, okay, go to, you know, say the future. And as I say, because, okay, theta 1 3 is not zero, and as a matter of fact, okay, is relatively large, surprisingly large. So this, okay, allow us now, okay, to carry out, okay, another generation of a reactor neutrino experiment. So namely, we can use it now to address, okay, the mass hierarchy problem. So this time again, okay, we have to look at, you know, the formula for, you know, the oscillation probability. Now it turns out, okay, if we write out all the terms, okay, completely, then you'll notice, okay, there are two terms depending on the delta m square 3 1. And the other one is, okay, delta m square 3 2. Now, because, okay, up to this point we have only three generations, so that means, okay, essentially, you know, one of, okay, say these two mass square difference actually can be expressed in terms of the other plus or minus, okay, say the delta m square, okay, 2 1, depending on whether we have, okay, a normal mass hierarchy or inverted mass hierarchy. Now, what does it mean? It turns out, okay, if we now have, okay, say normal mass hierarchy, then when we, okay, say now again draw the picture corresponding to this probability as a function of, okay, say the L over E quantity, then we'll see, okay, essentially, okay, a profile like this. Now this, okay, big distortion is due to theta 1 2. Now if we now look at, okay, say the profile more carefully, then you see, okay, there are a lot of fine structure. This, okay, is due to, you know, essentially, okay, these two terms. Now, if we have the normal mass hierarchy, then we have the blue curve there. Now, on the end, if we have, okay, say the inverted mass hierarchy, that means one of the terms now, okay, will have a phase shift. As a matter of fact, okay, you will see, okay, in this, okay, more prominent region, then the two mass hierarchy will give you, okay, essentially our phase, okay, information. So therefore, the idea for, okay, determining the mass hierarchy using the nuclear reactor is to study, okay, the fine structure of, okay, this oscillation pattern as careful as you can. So that means, okay, now you have to measure the energy very well, and also you have to have, okay, very high statistics, because, okay, if you have very low statistics, essentially, okay, there's no way you can, okay, determine the pattern well. So this is, okay, essentially the experimental challenge for determining determining the mass hierarchy of say the neutrinos using nuclear reactor. Now at this moment, the leading candidate going after the mass hierarchy using nuclear reactor is a journal experiment again in Guangdong. So notice, okay, Macau is over there. So right now the idea in China is to build a new underground lab, which is okay, the 700 meter okay, the into the rock. And because okay, now this time the detector is far away, 53 kilometers away from the reactor, they have to build a gigantic detector. So to give you some idea, this is okay, 20 kiloton liquid scintillator. If we okay, say put say the diabate detector into here, essentially it will be just about okay, one little square. To give you some idea about not say the different size. Or for the Kamlan experiment, it will be just okay, a small balloon inside okay, a big balloon. Right? Now, why not say Juno will pick okay, say this site? It turns out okay, at this moment, China is really busy in building okay, the nuclear power plants, and there's one new one building okay, in Yangjiang. Eventually we'll have okay, six okay, the nuclear reactors similar to okay, Daibei. And also in Taishan, there's also a new power plant okay, being built. And this one okay, will use okay, the third generation of okay, nuclear reactors in China. So as a result, okay, there will be four because you can see okay, the power of okay, say the individual core of the Taishan site is different. Right? So therefore, okay, you need fewer here, there. So the idea now is okay, put the detector essentially on equal distance from okay, these two power plants, so that okay, you can cancel some of the systematic. And as far as I know, okay, right at this moment, the Chinese team and also the European teams are very busy in doing okay, the R&D work, finalizing on the design of the detector. And also, okay, in the beginning of this year, they started to dig the tunnel and to get into the underground hall. So the goal is okay. The after no, they carry out no, a very rigorous program in the detector design and also in the liquid scintillator, then hopefully okay that they can achieve an energy resolution of about 3% or so. This is okay essentially the minimum. To give you some idea, for Daibei we reach okay an energy resolution about 8%, and also for Kamlan. It got to only 6%. So therefore, okay, this is a big jump in okay, the technology of liquid scintillator. The goal is okay, that Juno will come online okay, by 2020. Right? Now, the South Korean colleagues okay, are not okay, are not giving up yet. So in response to Juno, they decided to propose okay, a new experiment called okay, Reno 50. So the idea is okay, that they will use okay, the existing Juno experiment as okay, say that they have a near detector, and then about okay, 50 kilometers away into the mountain, then they will dig okay, an underground hole and build okay, a detector, which is still okay, very sketchy at this point. So the plan is okay, they will try not to come online okay, shortly after you know, the Juno experiment. So we will see okay, how okay, it will evolve in the next few years. Now, then with all these detectors, okay, naturally we want to know okay, how well they can measure you know, the mass hierarchy. So basically just to tell whether okay, we have normal or inverted. So the both experiment want to you know, essentially have a four standard deviation okay, discrimination after 6 years running. So that means okay, they will be well into okay, say the next decade in order to tell us okay, the sign of okay, say the mass hierarchy. Now in addition, then because they have now okay, huge detector, then they can measure now the other mixing parameter like theta 1-2 and the mass square differences, okay, the, you know, quite well. So these are the current precision of okay, these three parameters. And by the time okay, these two okay, the experiment run, then they hope to reach okay, essentially you know, okay, a percent. So certainly this will be very, very precise. All right, so I'm running out of time, so let me just zoom out. Use the next few minutes to give you, okay, say another fundamental
property of neutrino that can be addressed using a nuclear reactor. So this is okay, essentially not the magnetic movement of the neutrino. Now, it turns out okay that in order to okay say tackle this okay property on Earth, the best approach is okay to use low energy anti-neutrino from the reactor colliding with okay some material, in particular with the atomic electrons. Now it turns out okay if say the magnetic movement of okay the neutrino is zero, then okay the cross section for this process as a function of okay the recoil energy of the electron coming out okay will follow a curve okay like this. Okay, now on the hand, if the neutrino has some finite magnetic movement, then it will modify okay the cross section. In other words, okay the number of events okay we observed experimentally okay will be different. So for instance, okay for some assumed value for say the magnetic movement of the neutrino, then the curve okay will be okay something like this. So therefore, you can see okay experimentally, in order for us to say find out whether okay the neutrino has any magnetic movement or not, is to okay now try to detect electron coming out from okay say the scattering down to okay essentially tens of keV, and then see whether the number of events okay we detect is okay consistent with okay say the standard model or not. If we see okay more events than okay what the standard model predict, then basically we know okay the magnetic movement will be non-zero. Now since okay we are in Asia, so let me just okay highlight the experiment called Texano that was done okay using probably the only nuclear power plant okay in Taiwan near okay say Taipei. In order to perform this experiment, the detector has to be very close to okay, the nuclear core. As a matter of fact, for okay, the taxono is only about 28 meters away. Okay, now in order to see okay recoil the electron, rather than using liquid scintillator, taxono use okay the cesium iodide crystal coupled with okay sodium iodide crystal to detect okay say the electron and measure the energy of the recoil electron. So after a few years of running, they observed essentially no excess of okay the events as a function of the recoil energy, and because of okay say the this is consistent with okay zero, then they obtain okay essentially an upper limit of on the magnetic movement of the electron type of a neutrino to be 7.4 times 10 to the minus 11 the Bohr magneton. So this is okay roughly about okay one order of magnitude worse than okay what we can observe using okay say the astrophysical okay the say approach, and using a similar okay say the technique but using okay germanium detector in a Russian nuclear power plant. The Russian group okay recently established okay a better okay the limit on the magnetic movement of okay say the electron neutrino. So this is about roughly about a factor of 2.5 times okay better, and this is still okay ongoing, and we will see whether okay they can push to something okay more interesting or not. So just to summarize, you can see the nuclear reactor certainly is extremely useful to the scientific community, and hopefully okay through the talk now you understand okay the importance of okay nuclear reactors for us to understanding neutrino oscillation, and certainly you can see we still have a lot of okay say future planned experiment using nuclear reactor, so certainly there will be a lot of interesting results okay coming out okay from this kind of experiments okay in the future. Okay, thank you.
What's the time scale between Reno and Juno? Reno 50.
Well, Reno 50 in the public, they always say they will match the schedule of Juno. This is the same thing happened in the race between Taipei, Double Show, and Reno. So every time when Dai Bei publishes one result, they will publish another one.
What is the significance of getting
better and better precision in measuring theta 1-3?
Oh, it's a good question. Theta 1-3, as we talk, say at lunch, is one of the fundamental parameters of nature. So up to this moment, there is no theoretical prediction. So by measuring this, as precise as we can, similar to, the mass of a carbon atom, for instance, then we'll essentially set a reference, for, model building.
It seems like the thing that's still driving this is this mass hierarchy question. Let's say once you answer that, what's the significance of the answer to that question?
It's a good question. I didn't show the interaction between neutrino oscillation and also another class of experiment called neutrino-less double-beta decay. Because one of the open questions in neutrino physics is the nature of the neutrino. In other words, whether or not that is a Dirac type or a Majorana type. So if it's a Majorana, that means the neutrino and anti-neutrino essentially are identical. Right? Whereas the Dirac, they are different. And it turns out in order for us to use neutrino-less double-beta decay to address the nature of the neutrino, then we have to know the mass hierarchy. Because the current round of neutrino-less double-beta decay experiment we'll have a chance to get a non-zero value if it's inverted. But if the mass hierarchy is normal, it's essentially hopeless, I would say. Yeah. Or we need the younger generation to come up with new ideas to address that.
The neutrino magnetic moment, it's pretty close to zero, if not exactly zero. So the pursuit of closer and closer, lower and lower limit, would that settle any fundamental question or just an exercise toward zero?
Well, you're correct. No, certainly, if we have only the standard model, then the main movement of the neutrino indeed is very, very small. I think we are many, many order of magnitude away. However, if there's new physics, then it may show up, to give us a much larger magnetic moment. So that's why in this case, it's important to push. In particular, you can see the taxonal experiment. Actually, it's a very small experiment. So it's a lot cheaper. So it's worth doing if we have new ideas.
From PPT and it shows eigenvalue. By the way, I'm not a student in chemistry. I'm not a student in physics, I'm a chemistry student. Chemistry, and we also use eigenvalue to predict some chemical properties of some materials. So I don't know eigenvalue in your slide, what is the function of that eigenvalue means?
If we look at, that matrix equation again, so on one side, we have the neutrinos, the electron, muon, and the tau type. So those are the neutrinos that participate in weak interaction. Or, to put it simply, those are neutrinos that we observe, when we do experiment in the lab. Whereas, the free, the mass eigenstates, on the other side, if you remember, what we learned in quantum mechanics, so those are essentially, the basis that have, well-defined masses. So in other words to say, you may say, the masses of the electron and the muon and the tau neutrino we observed in the lab actually depends on the masses of those three states.
Okay, so if not, then let's thank Professor Luk again for a wonderful talk.